On this week's episode, we meet a couple of men with real issues. Look out, Johnny Appleseed.
Nope.
What did this tree ever do to deserve this? Eat a kite? Steal a cat? Beat around the bush? One thing is for sure, they definitely got an axe to grind. Why the deep-seated desire to fell a tree? Learn more about our woodsmen in this episode of Tough Grit. Whoa, Caleb, what are you doing there, man?
Oh, not a heck of a lot, Shannon. I just need to clear some space in these woods. So I was gonna drop a couple of these trees down, limb them up, and later buck logs and split them for firewood.
Buck logs and split them for firewood. I love it when you make up terms. But listen, you look like you got a job that you're cut out for. But if you wanna chop that work in half, why don't you lose that pocket knife and pick up one of these babies, huh? Oh, yeah, listen to that baby purr. Just like the one Daddy gave Mama on their wedding day.
Maybe you've had to mend fence at 2 a.m. or attach a rear-mounted PTO with little or no help. Or maybe you've had to fell a couple trees with little more than an axe. At some point, we've all found ourselves in a big pile of tough grit. I'm Caleb Regan.
And I'm Shannon Riley. And we know that when there's a tough job to do, you want to get that job done and done right the first time. That's where we come in. We're gonna be able to help you do this project with the proper tools and do it right the first time. And we're gonna throw a little competition in as well between rural neighbors. Here today, getting their hands dirty, are our two contestants.
Our first contestant is Tim Sweetek, who hails from Ames, Iowa. Tim lives on 3 acres, built his own home, and is a real do-it-yourselfer.
Look at this guy. He is so ready to cut down trees that I'm glad I'm not wearing trunks.
Contestant number two is Jim Haster, all the way from Wakarusa, Kansas. Jim also lives on 3 acres, heats his home with an outdoor wood-burning furnace, and has a free-range livestock business.
We should call this guy Autumn because his tree is gonna fall.
Gentlemen, welcome to Tough Grit.
Oh, we've got a great project for you today. Your challenge is... to fell and limb a tree.
We've got two similar trees set up for you today to fell and land on a target. Directional felling of trees is one of the most important skills for the small landowner to master, especially if they plan on using their timber for firewood, building materials, or simply want to clear some space.
Part two of the competition is to limb the trees using both a handsaw and a chainsaw. Now, it's no joking matter. More than 40,000 chainsaw accidents occur each year. Most common are injuries to the left leg and left hand. Yikes, if I couldn't use my hands, I wouldn't be able to talk. But you won't have to go about it alone. We've brought in some experts to help you along the way.
Team Grit, as always, we have Hank Will, who's editor-in-chief of Grit Magazine.
And one heck of a dancer, though he never lets me lead.
And our guest expert from Tractor Supply is John Wohler, manager of Tractor Supply in Lawrence, Kansas.
A man who's taken out more trees than a mess of beavers.
They'll coach you and give you advice on the best way to complete the challenge. Whichever one of you does the best in three categories, safety, accuracy, and efficiency, will win up to a $1,000 gift card to Tractor Supply Company. Now for felling these trees today, we're gonna be using an 18-inch chainsaw and complete chainsaw safety gear, which includes eye protection, a helmet, ear protection, a face mask, gloves, leg chaps, and heavy-duty boots. And in the second competition, we'll be using a bow saw.
Now, before we get started, let's get a heads up from our experts about what to expect.
Planning where your tree falls is one of the most important parts of the felling process. The first thing you gotta do is survey the area, take a look for any vines or power lines, houses, other buildings, whatnot, and then you just basically decide where it is you want your tree to fall.
Next, we're gonna establish the lean. You take the farthest limb to the left, the farthest limb to the right, dissect that vertically, and run a line straight to the ground. So the actual distance from the trunk to the imaginary line is your lean. Say, for instance, it's 3 feet to the left. you will want to aim 3 feet to the right, and therefore you'll hit your target.
Then you want to do the same for the front and back lean of the tree from position 90 degrees to the side. So if the tree is leaning backwards, you're going to have to use wedges during the felling process to push that tree down against your target.
For safety, it's important to have an escape route. Stay 15 feet away from the tree on the good side of the lean. The goal is to never turn your back on the tree, backing away, and plan your steps.
Also, be sure to use the appropriate safety equipment. You want to have head protection, and then if it has integrated ear and face protection, that's a good deal. You want to be sure to have a good pair of boots on, and you want to protect your legs with a pair of safety chaps. And then you want to be sure to check over your saw. You want to check all the safety equipment on the saw. You want to check the anti-kickback brake. Be sure that the air cleaner is not impeded. Check the blade. Blade needs to be sharp. This is a nice sharp one. And you want it to be tensioned properly, and this one's nice and tight.
Now it's time for the first part of our competition. Each contestant is going to try to bring down one of these trees right on target.
We laid out two flags. One each is an intended drop zone for each tree. The contestant who drops their tree on the flag will win using your best directional felling skills. If both of you manage to hit the flag, then we'll take a look at your technical cuts to determine the difference. Your coaches can help you, but they can't make any cuts. Good luck, guys.
Ready, set, go.
It's a lot harder when you gotta hurry.
Now, I'll be judging their work in three areas: how efficiently they make those technical cuts, then the accuracy of the trees fall onto the targets, and of course, doing it all safely.
And I'll be judging them on their beaver impersonations while they work.
Nope.
Okay, your first cut's gonna be at a 70 degree angle at the top of your notch. Finish the open face so we have a hinge. Right in and intersect with it. I think you're a little bit low on this side. I don't know how you're doing on that side. Yeah, so okay. Give it one more shot. A little below, so you're gonna have to finish this side. Grab them all, yep. Knock it out of there. Give it a good whack. There you go.
As our two teams release their inner lumberjack and try to bring their trees down, we'll take our first break. When we come back, we'll find out which team is a cut above the rest and whose bark is worse than their bite.
If you're cutting wood to stoke a fire, there are a few species that are more desirable than others. Most trees with the hardwood classification are fair game. A tree like Osage Orange is one of the most dense and hardest woods that you might have grown around your place. The upside is that you get lots of BTUs per cubic foot of the wood. The downside is that it's so hard it will quickly dull your chainsaw. It's really not too hard to split when it's green, though. White oak is often considered to be the most desirable heating wood. White oak has fewer BTUs of energy per cubic foot than Osage Orange, but it splits very easily, is more prevalent, and is easy on the chainsaws. Other decent and often very prevalent species that are certainly worth burning include sugar maple, red oak, white ash, and hackberry. Have a licensed chimney sweep inspect your chimney every summer and clean it if needed. Your fire department and your insurance agent will be glad you did.
Welcome back to Tough Grit. Each team member is working hard to bring their tree down right on target. Now, they started by making a hinge, starting with the face notch.
Both teams are using their chainsaws right now, making that face notch, then they'll make a back cut, taking the lean of the tree into account.
Now you gotta take the back edge above this hinge so we get a good hinge. You just cut her straight back right in there. Is that right here? Yes. Go a little more horizontal. Tip the part, your part down. Go this way. Good, right there. Give it a little bit more on your side. Stick a wedge in there. I think if you insert the wedge here, just drive it home, I think we'll get that thing to hit that flag. That's right, now give it a couple of good whacks, and when it starts to fall, don't forget about your escape route. Keep going, you got her. Here she comes. Ah. Timber, let's go. It ain't gonna go.
Yeah, it's going.
There she goes, let's go, let's get back.
Tree coming down. Tree coming down. Slow motion. Not even. Oh.
Oh crap. You're kidding me.
Well, it's a learning point.
This is kind of a dangerous situation. If you're up to it, you can go ahead and trim that hinge a little bit, but just be ready to bail.
Bail out.
Okay.
Be careful.
Tree coming down.
Tree coming down. Nice work, Jim.
Hey, it's down and we're in one piece.
Had a bit of an angle there.
Yeah, I didn't have a real good front cut there, actually.
All right, gentlemen, great job. The trees are down in the ground. What did you think of those cuts there, Caleb?
Well, number one thing is they both landed on the ground safely, so well done on both counts on that one. Both face cuts came in a little bit narrow. You normally want your face cut to be about 70 degrees and that notch to be about 20% of the diameter of the tree. Both of them were about 50%. Which in this case left a hinge that's about 20 to 30% of the diameter of the tree. You normally want that to be about 10% up near the front, but overall, well done.
But don't feel bad, at least you're styling. You look like 1/4 of the village people.
Tim, John, well done. Congratulations on winning a $500 gift card to Tractor Supply Company.
Thank you very much.
Next time you'll channel your inner beaver and you'll bring down the tree all by yourself.
Looking forward to it.
Now that both trees are on the ground, it's time to clean up this mess.
When we come back, we'll show you the proper way to limb a tree. We'll see who will leave with the next $500 gift card from Tractor Supply Company, and who's leaving with just the logs. All right, now that the tree's on the ground, you have no choice but to start limbing, unless you've got 1,000 little termites on you. Now, limbing is a process of removing all of the branches off of the tree and moving them to a brush pile.
Before you even reach for a chainsaw, there's several things you need to do. Hank, where do we start?
So the first thing you want to do is make sure that your felled tree is all the way on the ground. You can see that this particular tree is not all the way on the ground. Normally, you'd remove these things with some sort of a mechanical device like a tractor or a skidder. But you can see that if we take some care while limbing it, that this particular branch is really responsible for holding the bulk of it up. If we get parts of it trimmed, we can probably roll it over by hand safely.
Take a moment, let's refuel, rest, and that'll give us a chance for anything that's up in the trees to fall. Observation is the key to safety. As you're limbing this, make sure to take your time, clear your debris as you're going to keep the area clean, safe, so there's no danger or tripping hazards. This big branch right here might be one of them you want to get rid of first, and you'll have to watch to make sure that the tree does not shift when you do that. When you're cutting for firewood, might be a good idea to start at the top of the tree, smaller branches, and you work your way down to the trunk. And as you get down to the trunk, keep your chain out of the dirt. That'll keep it from getting dull.
And when you're limbing with a chainsaw, you want to be sure that you're not working above your shoulders. With a bow saw, you can work really pretty much at any level. You want to be sure that you've got good footing at all time. You want to be watching the tree, in this case in particular, because it is a little bit raised off the ground, to be anticipating any rocking or moving so that you don't get rolled on and injured. And whatever you do, pay particular attention to the tip of the chainsaw, because that's the point at which you can get some crazy kickbacks and could wind up slicing your head.
Now it's time for a little fun. Our contestants have to remove the limbs from their trees. And just to keep it interesting, for the first 6 minutes, you're gonna be using a bow saw. And for the next 3 minutes, you use a Husqvarna chainsaw. It's a real mano-a-machino competition. But it's not just about speed. It's also about efficiency, accuracy, and safety. And if we feel like you're not following safety, we'll call attention to it and we'll dock 30 seconds from your time.
When you get to the chainsaw, move deliberately. Let off the throttle while you're adjusting your footing and just move down the tree methodically and carefully.
Ready, set, go.
Go, let's go. Ready your helmet if you want to. All right, Jim, let's start on these small ones. Sweet. Go, keep going, there's another one there.
What I'm looking for when it comes to efficiency is the guy who's gonna be quick and thorough. I'll be counting the number of limbs they get off the tree. As for accuracy, I want to see nice, close, clean, straight cuts. And as for safety, they should always be cleaning out the debris away from the trunk as they work and watching their footing and making sure the tree doesn't roll on them.
Oh, you're doing great. This is great. I'm just going to have you stay right there. How about this guy here?
Oh, we got some branches here in between your legs. You need to clear those branches out as you're working.
Keep going. I'd come out from this angle and just go straight in. That'll get you a clean cut. Yep, right there. Excellent. That's a good straight cut. Yep, clear that out.
There you go. Just move up to that next one there. Boy, there's hardly going to be anything left for the chainsaw except for the big stuff.
Getting close.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Time! Hold up.
All right, so which team is gonna win the chainsaw challenge? And which team is gonna have to learn how to only count to 9? Woo-hoo. Find out when we return after this.
Before heading out to the woods to do a little tree cutting, it's important to have the right tools in your toolkit and on your body. The most important items in your toolkit have to do with safety, and nothing will keep you safer than Husqvarna's chaps. Believe it or not, the fibers in these chaps can stop a full speed cutting chain before it turns into a massacre. Add proper canvas clothing, steel toe boots, head, ear, and eye protection, and you're good to go. Don't let your safety gear lull you into a false sense of security. Use your eyes, ears, and your head. Don't rely on just your safety gear. No matter how well equipped you are, if you aren't thinking clearly or you are mentally fatigued, it's probably safer and more fun to send the chips flying another day when you are sharp and well rested. Working in the woods with powerful machinery is satisfying, even exhilarating, but it can become deadly in the blink of an eye. As with any work out here, get the training you need, be smart, play it safe. You'll reap the benefits for years to come.
We're on the last leg of the final challenge as these guys try to strip the limbs off the trees.
And I gotta tell you, I've seen dieters attack a salad bar with more energy.
Nice. All right. There you go. Run down this side of the tree, around the other side. All right, let's start down at the end, at the top of the tree, and we'll work our way back. Start with this one and this one. We'll drag those out of our way. Go ahead and do a down cut on that one. Should be okay. One of those at a time. We'll call that one a trim.
have to put your foot up to spread it out, put some weight up there. Is that working? There you go. Now go ahead and go from the top.
Good job. Dive, dive.
Dive.
Whoa.
Jim,
dive. Dive.
Well, we're ready for firewood here.
All right, gentlemen, come on in.
Come on in.
All right, Caleb, who won the Lemming Challenge?
Well, I got to give Lemming to Jim here. He absolutely throttled Tim with the bow saw, and then when he picked up the chainsaw, he was safe the whole time. We never had to dock either contestant for safety, but he was clearing limbs out while he was working, moving quick, working fast, and just outworked him.
And he never looked like a woodchuck while he was doing it.
You? Not so much.
Anyway, you both win a $500 gift card from Tractor Supply Company. $500 for the felling and $500 for the limbing. What are you guys going to get with your gift cards?
I think I'm going to get a sprayer pulled behind my tractor.
Well, good plan. How about you, sir?
I think I'll get some portable electric fencing.
Okay, don't mix those together. That's water and electricity, and a bad idea. Now for you at home, would you like to be a part of the Tough Grit Rural American Challenge? Well, here's how you can do it.
If you'd like to be on Tough Grit, the Rural America Challenge, go to toughgrit.com and click on the I Can Do That button. Or look for the advertisement in Grit Magazine. Don't wait, sign up today.
And now you know all you need to know about felling and limbing a tree. Glad you could join us. Hope to see you next time.
And remember, if a tree falls in a forest and nobody's around to hear it, I bet it swears like a sailor on leave. I'm Shannon Riley.
I'm Caleb Regan.
And when you see the two of us coming, you know you're in Tough Grit. On next week's episode, we're finding our inner caveman and creating fire. We've got an itching, and we've got some burning. Thank goodness there's an ointment for that. So hot, you should move anything you have on top of your TV to a safe place. So throw on some animal skins and grab that axe. It's almost time to light this fire. In the next episode of Tough Grit.